Well, I think we'll go ahead and get started, and pleasure to welcome everyone to the second series of Dean seminars on chronic diseases. This one, and this morning we're going to move fairly far upstream in terms of the forces that generate risk for chronic diseases, and hear a little bit about telomeres and their influence on chronic disease vulnerability, pathogenesis possibly, and very importantly, we'll hear from two major experts in this area, and we'll come away, I'm sure, informed. Telomeres, I'm sure everyone here knows, are specialized segments. They're repeats of DNA at the ends of chromosomes that have evolved, I guess this is fair to say, to protect the ends, to stabilize the ends of chromosomes so that they don't fuse together and disrupt cellular replication. They shorten every time a cell divides. Ultimately, cell senescence appears to be determined, at least in part, by the extent of that shortening over time. Telomere shortening and length, for that matter, are impacted substantially by an RNA reverse transcriptase called telomerase, which adds base pairs at the ends of chromosomes with each cell division, but never quite compensates for the loss that's occurred, that's mandatorily incurred with each cell replication. A variety of diseases and metabolic functions and factors, biological factors, have been related, at least anecdotally, to telomere shortening. I mean, telomere length has been connected to leptin levels, to insulin resistance, to oxidative stress, to inflammation, and to a variety of disorders, including obesity and diabetes and osteoporosis, dementia, cardiovascular risk, not trivially, cancer, and longevity. Quite interestingly, physical activity, smoking, low socioeconomic status have all been associated with telomere length as well. Cause and effect, not so clear, but the associations are there and await a clarification, I think it's fair to say. There are a number of questions that arise in connection with telomere biology. Many more will occur to you. How much variation in telomere length is there at birth? How is it determined? Is that heritable? Does it segregate by population subsets? Does telomere length at birth segregate by socioeconomic status of the parents, by parental age, by a variety of other things? How do shorter telomeres get associated with chronic disease and longevity to the extent that they are? Is everybody with equivalent telomere length at equivalent risk of chronic disease or at equivalent levels of protection? And I think very importantly and intriguingly, how do socioeconomic forces and lifestyle factors affect, as they appear to do, telomere length? That really is, to me, a fantastic association Anyway, we have two experts with us today, as I said, who not only work in the field, but work together and on some of these issues. Dr. Abraham Aviv is the Director of Human Development and Aging and Professor of Pediatrics and Medicine at Rutgers and the New Jersey Medical School. He holds his MD from Upstate Medical Center and trained in pediatrics at New York Hospital Cornell at a time when I was there in an adjacent silo. I don't think we ever laid eyes on each other, but in any event, we were nearby. He's published very extensively in telomere biology. He's been a voice of caution about reading biological cause and effect into associations, and has been, as I said, a major voice for careful interpretation of what we're about in this field, which is explosively increasing in complexity and pace, in good measure due to his work. Our lead discussant today is Dr. Pam Factor-Litvak, Associate Professor of Epidemiology and Associate Dean for Research Resources. Here at the Mailman School, she holds a Master's in Public Health from Harvard, two MPhils, one from Yale and one from Columbia, and a PhD from Columbia. She's about as degreed as it's safe to get, I think. She's published widely on environmental toxicants and life course issues, has worked with Dr. Ezra Susser and Dr. Aviv on telomeres, as a matter of fact. Dr. Aviv has titled his presentation, as you see, Telomeres in Human Health, The Illusion of Knowledge. So, Dr. Aviv, welcome to our shores.
Thank you very much. It is really a pleasure to be here. I couldn't resist the second part of this title, The Illusion of Knowledge. The lavalier. It's on, yeah. Yeah. Anybody hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. No, so could you put, I hear very well myself. So could you bring the volume up somehow? Anybody? Okay. So I couldn't resist the second part of this talk, The Illusion of Knowledge. This was introduced about half a century ago by Burstein, who was the librarian of the Congress. And he wrote some wonderful scientific books. It's very easy, you know, to fill the void of ignorance. But it's very, very difficult to replace dogmas. And I believe that the telomere field now is replete with dogmas, and I'll share some of these dogmas with you. Now, companies or entities that offer telomere measurements directly to the public or to physicians have websites. And this is basically the message that you get from this website. Now, these companies include entities that were established by eminent scientists in the field of telomere biology. For example, Life Length was established by a woman named Maria Blasco, which is very famous in the field. Telome Health was established by Calvin Harley and Elizabeth Blackburn. Elizabeth Blackburn, in fact, got the Nobel Prize for the discovery of telomeres. So is it true that if we do the right thing, we could actually critically attenuate the rate of our telomere shortening and perhaps even lengthen our telomeres? The answer is probably not. And the reason for that is that the telomere health aging connection is largely determined at birth. And by the way, the structure that you see around there are the telomeres, and the chromosome, the tip of the chromosomes are the telomeres. So here's the outline of my talk. I'll cover in broad strokes the story of telomere biology, the meaning of leukocyte telomeric lengths, LTL, which is the parameter that they use in epidemiological studies to look at telomeres in humans, the concept of synchrony in telomeric lengths in vivo, synchrony in telomeric attrition and stem cell kinetics, discuss briefly the links between LTL and atherosclerosis. Discuss the sex effect on LTL, the genetics of LTL, and the effect of paternal age at conception, PAC, on telomeres, which is a wonderful emerging story. Then talk about the telomeric brink, that is, the critically short telomeres, the beyond that human could not live. So telomeres are the TTAGGG tandem repeats at the end of the chromosomes. And together with telomere-binding protein, they cut the chromosomes and protect them from nasty things like genomic instability. Human telomeres are very short. In fact, humans have the shortest telomeres among mammals. And during the course of about 100 years, we lose about 4.5 kilobases of telomeres, and 2 kilobases are lost in the first 20 years of life. Now, when I put this slide together perhaps 10 years ago, there was a question about whether telomeres are the biomarker of human aging. There is no doubt that this is the case. But I would like to propose to you for the first time that, in fact, I now believe that telomeres are the biodeterminant of human aging. So as somatic cells divide in culture or in vivo, the telomeres undergo shortenings until a critically short telomeric length is attained, when a signal is relayed to the replicative machinery of the cell to stop replication. This is referred to as the Hayflick limit of replicative senescence. Some cells possess the enzyme telomerase. This is a reverse transcriptase that adds back telomere repeats onto the ends of the chromosomes. And when these cells divide, the telomeres do not undergo progressive shortening. They are immortal. This includes embryonic stem cells, the germline stem cells, and cancer cells. This is the enzyme telomerase. It has two major components, the template to build the telomeres, and then TERT, which is the catalytic subunit of the enzyme. The enzyme is very active in utero, but it is suppressed, not totally inhibited, in somatic tissues during extrauterine life. And what about oxidative stress and inflammation? Oxidative mutagenesis, as you know, could cause cancer. Lipid peroxidation could cause atherosclerosis. But oxidative stress also accelerates telomeric attrition with replication. And the reason for that is that the G triplets on the telomeres, TTAGGG, those repeats are highly sensitive to the hydroxyl radical. In fact, telomeres are the most sensitive component of the human genome to oxidative stress. And then in the hematopoietic system, inflammation accelerates telomere shortening because inflammation entails more replications of hematopoietic stem cells that give rise to leukocytes that are involving the inflammatory response. More replication, more telomere shortening. So what do we mean by leukocyte telomeric length? This is the parameter that we use to monitor telomere dynamics in humans. We have two boundaries of life, birth and death, and in between, our hematopoietic stem cells replicate. And as they replicate, their telomeres undergo progressive shortening. And this is mirrored in telomere shortening in leukocytes. What's the reason for the rapid telomeric length at early life? Those of you who have children, I went to the pediatrician. This is the growth chart the pediatrician used to follow your kids' growth. And you could see there is very rapid growth, of course, during early life. Then they have a slowing down. And then again, you have a pickup during the growth, during the adolescent years. That requires tremendous amount of adjustment in the body. And one adjustment, of course, is to expand the hematopoietic stem cell pool in parallel to the growth of the soma. So the expansion of that pool is done through what we call symmetric replication, whereby an hematopoietic stem cell divides into daughter stem cells. This type of expansion of the hematopoietic stem cell pool does not need really many replications. But if you think about a 3-kilogram newborn and a 70-kilogram adult male, well, maybe in America it's 90-kilogram adult male. But so you have 3 to 6, one replication of hematopoietic stem cells, 6 to 12, and you make the calculation, you need about 5 replications to expand the hematopoietic stem cell pool in tandem with the growth of the body. But you need tremendous number of replication to expand the progenitor cell pool. These are the more differentiated cells in the hematopoietic stem cells, in the hematopoietic system, that give rise to peripheral leukocytes. There you need, the replication is one hematopoietic stem cell divide into a daughter stem cell to maintain the pool, and another one divide asymmetrically to create the progenitor cell. And then those progenitor cells divide to sub-progenitor cells, on and on. This is a replication 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and it's tremendous number of replications that one needs to create this vast progenitor cell pool that accommodate the daily needs of the individual. Now, an individual adult produces about 400 billion cells a day. Anybody would venture to guess how frequently hematopoietic stem cell divide per year? Any suggestion? Any medical student here? It's about once a year. So you need a tremendous pool of progenitor cells to accommodate these daily needs. So during that period of time of growth, most of telomere shortening happens because of the production of this huge pool of progenitor cells in the hematopoietic system. So here we'll like to discuss the concept of synchrony in telomeric length and its dynamics. At birth, telomeric length is synchronized among tissue. Here's an example of leukocyte, WBC, white blood cells, and the solid tissue of the umbilical artery. And what you see there is basically they're identical, the length of the telomeres in both tissues. But please note the tremendous range of telomeric lengths among newborns. It's about 4 kilobases this way and 4 kilobases this way. We don't know what happened to these individuals that have long telomeres versus these individuals that have short telomeres at birth later in life. But we do know that synchrony is maintained throughout life. Here we are looking at adults between the age of 20 and 70 years. We got tissues from blood, subcutaneous skin, skeletal muscle, and subcutaneous fat. For example, you look at this panel, we are correlating leukocyte versus skeletal muscle. Individual endowed with long telomeres in one tissue will have long telomeres in other tissues. But please notice that in terms of leukocyte and skeletal muscle, the data is below the line of identity because telomeres are much shorter in leukocytes compared to skeletal muscle. But if you have long telomeres in one tissue, you will have long telomeres in other tissues. And the same thing goes here. This is leukocyte versus fat. Again, fat is a poorly proliferative tissue again, leukocytes have shorter telomeres than in fat, but long telomeres in fat have long telomeres in leukocytes and so on. This has happened to be skin, so it's said to be skin is a highly proliferative tissue, so you could see that when you have two proliferative tissues, then telomere lengths in between those tissues are more similar. But here's the remarkable thing that we found, and that is that if you look at telomere shortening, now you're looking at telomeric lengths in this four tissue versus age, the rate of telomere shortening is regardless of the replicated nature of this tissue. So whether you have skeleton, muscle or leukocytes, the rate of telomere shortening is the same. How could this be? And the answer is in the model that, in fact, I described to you before. In the hematopoietic system, you need tremendous number of progenitor cell pools to accommodate the daily needs of the individual. So during growth and development, you have developed this huge pool of progenitor cell. And during this time, of course, telomeres will undergo rapid shortening because of this asymmetric replication of stem cells. Skeletal muscle, because it does not divide much during adult life, does not require this progenitor cell pool. They have some satellite cells, the stem cells are ready to divide the moment the muscle has injury. So because of that, the size of the progenitor cell pool is very small, then the need to replication during growth and development is small. But for housekeeping activity during adult life, the stem cell in skeletal muscle divide at the same rate as that in leukocyte. And that's the reason the rate of telomere shortening is basically the same. And here's another fascinating story, and that is the concept that if already you have telomere lengths determined primarily during growth and development, because that's when the rapid rate of telomere shortening is happening. Later in life, you maintain tracking of your telomeric length. So if you endow with long telomeres at one age, you're more likely to have long telomeres at any other age through your adult life. And here what we did, we look at four groups. Since we could not cover the entire lifespan, this group have different ages at baseline, and they range from these groups at baseline telomeric the study is about 30 years. The LSADT is about, the baseline is 75 years. But you could see that over the course of about 12 years, those individuals that have long telomeres in the leukocyte or short telomere in the leukocyte will maintain their ranking and will demonstrate the phenomena of tracking. So what do we know about telomeres and diseases of aging? I would like to focus on atherosclerosis primarily because this is the entity that has been studied more than any other time. So both the disease itself and the risks for the disease are usually seen in the general population. They're all associated with short telomeric length. And as you know, telomeric length is also associated with shorter lifespan. I'll show you some data on this later. And then women have longer telomere than men in about 150 base pair, which is in telomeric year equivalence, is about 5 years of the human lifespan, which is about the difference in life expectancy between women and men in modern societies. A word about atherosclerosis aging. What does it mean? As you perhaps know, these are diseases associated with increased inflammatory burden and with oxidative stress burden. Since inflammation is associated with increased hematopoietic stem cell replication, and as you had before, oxidative stress accelerate telomere shortening per replication, it seemed though that leukocyte telomeric length is a record of the cumulative burden of oxidative stress and inflammation over the individual lifetime. So because of that, the orthodoxy in the field of telomere biology was that the association between short telomeric lengths and atherosclerosis has to do with the fact that telomeres undergo much faster rate of telomere shortening in those individuals that are prone to atherosclerosis versus their peers. They do not manifest the clinical expressions of the disease. But is it true? In fact, I perpetuated this notion for many years. Well, as I mentioned to you before, the difference across newborns in telomeric length is about 5 kilobits. During the course of growth and development, we lose about 2 kilobases of telomeres. But during the entire adult life course, we lose about only 2.5 kilobases of telomeres. And please remember this slide that, in fact, individuals maintain the short or long telomeres over their adult life course. You don't have to be a Nobel Prize winner to realize that from the standpoint of leukocyte telomeric length dynamics, in many persons, the die for atherosclerosis and longevity is cast during the first 20 years of life. There's no other way. So the majority of individuals that display atherosclerosis and other diseases of aging, they had short telomeres at birth, and perhaps they lost some during growth and development, but the main determinants are the first 20 years of life. So we have been focusing on this component of telomere dynamics in terms of life course, but in reality, to understand telomeres and aging, we have to focus on early life. So instead of studying this old man and his middle-aged son, the focus should be on the grandson. And let me go back to the sex effect along the same story or message that I would like to convey to you. Women have longer telomeres than men, and we show that in multiple studies. There are dozens and dozens of studies that show that. This happened to be a Danish cohort, a French cohort, a Flemish cohort, the Framingham Heart Study, the Cardiovascular Health Study, and the Family Heart Study. But in fact, this has been shown again and again. By the way, it's interesting to note that African American as a group have much longer telomeres than whites, and it's a story by itself, and I will not go into detail about this now. But the fact is that women have longer telomeres than men. And why is it so? So again, the dogma has been that it has something to do with estrogen and telomeres. And the reason for that is that the promoter region of the enzyme telomerase, the promoter region is called TERT, of the catalytic subunit, is an estrogen response element. So estrogen stimulates telomerase. So the argument has been that during the premenopausal period, the rate of telomere shortening is attenuated in women because of estrogen. But nobody will perform a longitudinal study to see if this is the case. So we did, and this is a paper that's still in preparation. And what we did here, we are looking at, this is, by the way, a twin study. It's a Danish twin cohort. And we had a follow-up of 12 years. So some of the women had menopause at baseline and follow-up. Already they reached menopause. Other twins had no menopause at baseline, but they reached menopause at follow-up. And the youngest twins, of course, had did not reach menopause at baseline and follow-up. And we followed them for 12 years. And we stratified the males within the age ranges of the pre, peri, and postmenopausal ages of the women. And what you could see, just the opposite what we anticipated, that is, in fact, the premenopausal women had the fastest telomere attrition, and the postmenopausal women had the slowest telomere attrition, and males show the opposite direction. But these are highly, highly significant differences. So there is no evidence for telomerase-mediated attenuation of telomere attrition. But what we know from animal studies is that estrogen actually stimulates hematopoietic stem cell replication. And moreover, women menstruate. And on average, you lose about 40 to 50 ml per menstruation for a woman. That's cumulatively is about half a liter of blood loss a year. So we believe that, in fact, what we see here is a phenomena that is just the opposite of what is the dogma in the field of telomere biology. So what is the reason that women have longer telomeres than men? It definitely happens prior to adult life. And there is a hint for the cause. And this comes from this component of the study. Here we are looking at same sex and other sex twins. So the other sex twins are, of course, dizygotic twins by definition. Same sex could be either monozygotic or dizygotic. So if you look at the relationship between women and men among the same sex twins, they behave exactly like singletons. That is, telomeres are longer in the women than in the men. Both at baseline exam, this is the baseline exam, this is the follow-up exam 12 years later. But if you look at the other sex twins, telomeric length in the males and females is identical. And telomeric length in the females is the same like males in the same-sex twins. So let's think what happened in utero. In utero, you have, if you have dizygotic cord twins, they have two different placenta like this scenario. If you look at dizygotic twins, which are two different placenta, but the same sex, would be this scenario. And then monozygotic twin, they could be sharing only one placenta or two placenta. But the important thing is that monozygotic twins and dizygotic twins are the same sex, exposed to the same intrauterine environment with respect to sex. But these twins share different environment with respect to sex. So something about the intrauterine environment, that the presence of the male fetus by the female fetus, suppress telomere lengths in the fetus. You think that this is crazy, right? But in fact, there are wonderful studies in multiplacenta mammals to show that here's the female is situated between two males. It takes on the characters both anatomically and behaviorally of the male cord twins, male animals, male fetuses. And a lot of studies this also in other sex human twins, that the females have much more a behavior of men if it is another sex twin. And there are also anatomical features in those females that suggest they were under the influence of something that is going on in utero. So I would suggest to you the possibility that, in fact, that the sex difference between women and men in telomeres is probably in utero. So what about the genetics of telomeres and the PAC effect? PAC is the paternal age at conception effect. First of all, telomeres is a highly heritable genetic trait. And because of that, of course, we identify one after other the genes that explain the inter-individual variation in telomeric lengths in the population at large. And we find them one after the other. There are two consortia, basically. One consortia runs in the United States under the directorship of my group. Another one is the European consortium. And we are exchanging continuously data. So one by one, as the population that we genotype get bigger and bigger, we will identify those genes. All of these genes, one way or another, are actually telomere-regulating genes. More interesting is that those genes, and now without even measurement of leukocyte telomeric lengths, are found to be associated with cardiovascular disease. So you're looking at the combination of several genes that have been linked through GWAS studies to telomeres, and those genes in and of themselves, the minor allele of those genes, forecast cardiovascular disease. But here's an interesting stuff, really interesting. While in somatic tissue, telomeres undergo shortening, as you see here in leukocytes. In the male germline, in sperm, telomeres become longer with age. The reason for this, we believe, is because his robust telomerase activity in germ stem cells of the male. It's suppressed in somatic tissues, but it is active in the germline. So there are two ways how telomeres could become longer in sperm. One way is basically that all sperm have longer telomeres. So what we do here, we are looking at the distribution of telomeres in all the sperm. What we did basically, we took sperm, we extract DNA, and measure telomeres by southern blots, which basically tell us telomeric lengths in all the sperm as a group. So what you see is that basically the distribution of the sperm is shifted by redistribution toward longer telomeres. This is a model of redistribution as, this is an hypothetical model, showing that this is, could be a shift from this distribution to this with emergence of sperm with longer telomeres. Or you could have, of course, a shift of the entire distribution to the right. Based on the southern blood, there is a suggestion that what we see here is actually is the emergence of sperm with longer telomeres. But to prove that, we have to look at each sperm as a unique genetic entity rather than just put them all together. And to measure telomeres in individual sperm, we have to use another technology, which is based on fluorescence in situ hybridization. And we did this, we found exactly the same thing. And that is what we see here, is the emergence of a subset of sperm in all the people that have longer telomeres. So one possibility, of course, that this emergence is a process of selection with age, that the sperm that emerge to have longer telomeres are the one also that maybe have more robust telomerase activity. Another one is that all germ stem cells have increasing telomerase activity and they overshoot, their enzyme overshoots, so you have a shift of the entire distribution. But as you notice already, there is a suggestion there is actually the emergence of stem cells that have longer telomeres and give rise to sperms that have longer telomeres. Why is it important? as you all know, there is now a tendency to having children at an older age. And telomeres in the offspring, their lengths relate to paternal age. This is the first study, and nobody believed that study. I reviewed this study. And when I saw that study, I said, this is ridiculous. There's tremendous scatter of the data here. This is a very small cohort. I recommended this paper to be rejected. The editor was smarter than I, and he saw something here. I then received several telephone calls from colleagues in which we do telomere measurement for different groups. And I said, I think this is all nonsense. I'll prove it to you that it's nonsense. If you have paternal age at conception, see what you get. So we put it all together, and the paper just came before our paper that showed the same phenomena in a large cohort. And then here's our paper, multiple groups. This is Framingham heart study, family heart study, Danish twins. These are very old twins. This is the family heart study and twins UK. It's tremendous scatter of the data, but again and again, in every single study that look at the pack effect, they show that offspring of older fathers have longer telomeres. And there's another interesting thing, and it's again a study in twins. When we look at the pack effect on monozygotic twins, there's not much of an effect. But look at the dizygotic twins, something very remarkable is happening here, and that is the dizygotic twins start looking more alike with respect to telomeric length. I thought that this is crazy. I didn't believe that. But this is about 800 twins. So I went to Twins UK, in which you measure telomeres is about 2,000 twins, and found the exact phenomenon. Paternal age at conception increased the similarity in telomeric length between dizygotic twins. It lengthened the telomeres in all twins, but dizygotic twins become more similar with respect to telomeric length. So how could this be? In the Drosophila, we don't have any experience in humans, so we have to go to fruit flies. The germ cells are organized in niches. This has also happened in humans. And different stem cells have different lineages, so they are represented here in different colors, three colors, red, blue, and green. So you look at the old Drosophila, something remarkable is happening there. All at once, one lineage of stem cells take over. And the thinking is, in this case, it's the red. The thinking is that what happened is that some subset of germ cells are not resilient enough against aging, and they vanish and die. And then the more resilient germ cells expand to clonal expansion. So what you see is that at the level of the germ cells, you have more and more germ cells that are alike with age because they survived aging. Now suppose that the distribution of telomeres is that. Those are the green short telomeres, blue are the intermediate telomeric lengths, and the reds are the one with the longer telomeres. These are the more resilient stem cells. So of course, with age, the distribution will go a bit to the right in terms of telomere lengthening. In fact, you don't even need this model because at the level of the germ cell, as we discussed before, with active telomerase, every time a cell replicates, telomeres become a little bit longer. So since the red ones undergo more clonal expansion, the telomeres become longer. The message is, however, that at the level of the sperm, you will have more representation of the germ stem cells that are red. So let's see what the impact will be in terms of the twins. In dizygotic twins, you are more likely, since the three are equally, the three gem stem cells are represented here, that in dizygotic twins, and dizygotic twins are the product of two sperms, it is more likely that the two sperms that hit the dizygotic twins will be different. In monozygotic twins, it doesn't make any difference. It will be only one sperm. But later in life, this dizygotic twin are more likely to be hit by the same sperm, so they become more alike. So we believe that we are witnessing a phenomena of selection at the level of the germline. So finally, I want to talk about this fascinating theoretical model that we have about the so-called telomeric brink. And telomeric brink, I relate to the lengths of telomeric lengths beyond which survival in human is impossible. Now, there are quite a few studies on the relationship between telomeric lengths and mortality in the elderly. This is a more recent one on the cardiovascular health study. And the message here is simple. You have shorter telomeres, your risk of dying from all causes increase substantially. And the genes, one of the genes that associated with telomeric lengths in the general population has now been shown to be associated with longevity in human as well. So I don't know if you know this famous paper in Science by Oppen and Vopol, and they argued that during the last 150 years, there been basically a linear increase in life expectancy in humans. And they anticipate that those individuals were born the last decade will make it to, about half of them will make it to 100 years during the next century. So is it so? Well, is there really a level in which telomere become so short that basically the bottom drop out? We believe yes, and the telomeric length is about 4.5 kilobases. And here's the evidence to support this. This is data from a lot of studies that we did for different groups. And here we plot telomeric length versus age for females and males. Please note that among younger individuals, that means individuals younger than about age 90 years, there is no individual that have telomeric lengths below 4.5 kilobases. There's some here in exceptionally old people. Now, I believe that the reason we see that in exceptionally old individuals, the telomeric lengths below 4.5 kilobases is as follows. Usually when we recruit people for studies, we take basically people that are relatively healthy. They could have disease, but they're ambulatory. They're coming to a clinic. They're coming to a place for blood, the blood to be taken and other parameters to be measured. But when we are dealing with exceptionally old people, we'll take everybody. We go to nursing homes with that individual. We'll take sick people, people that are imminent death very soon, because we need all of this individual to our studies. So when we look at individuals older than 90, they are very selective population. First of all, they are very selected just to begin with because they survive to 90 years. But also very selected because we take all of them, because we need all of them for our studies. So when we see that short telomeres in this age group, it's not surprising. We don't see it in individuals maybe that are in the 20 or 30 because these are people that are healthy or even 70s. So we ask a very simple question. If you know telomeric length, the given individual, you know the country that this individual comes from, and you know the sex of the individual. You know the country, you know the life expectancy of that individual for his sex, for that country. So through simulation and computation, you could predict for a given rate of telomere shortening, if you're age 35, 50, 65, and so on, what is the likelihood is that you are going to reach your telomeric brink of 4.5 kilobases before your life expectancy. So if you reach that before your life expectancy, it means that telomeres will impact your life expectancy. So we do it for two types of assumption. First, just at the time that there was blood drawn from you, the life expectancy at the time, and also the predicted life expectancy according to the poll studies that half of us will live to 100 in about the next couple of generations. So the dotted plot is just telomeric, the time to which the probability of reaching the brink of 4.5 kilobases for different rate of telomere shortening. And you could see basically is that it's very low for the general population if you are dealing with age 35 years old. But it's coming very fast if you're dealing with individuals in which you expect life expectancy to see 100 years. But this is the general population. This is just all individuals that have all the range of telomeric lengths. But when we narrow our to individuals that have short telomeres to begin with, remember that you could divide them. Here we are looking by quintiles. So if you look at the lowest 20th percentile of the population, what you could see is that, in fact, even now, with our life expectancy, a lot of individuals will never reach the full life expectancy because the telomeres are simply too short. And basically, if you're dealing with 100 years of life expectancy, the majority of individuals will never make it if they are having short telomeres to begin with. And the other panel display the same idea. So what all of this means, remember my first slide was the question. We had that idea that telomeres maybe is a biomarker of human aging. We progress to believe that it is definitely a biomarker. And I'm telling you that I believe that it's in fact a biodeterminant in human aging. So what's the reason for that? First of all, I demonstrated to you the phenomenon of antecedence. You have short or long telomeres many years before the event, whether it's cardiovascular disease or death in any cause. I demonstrate the concept of directionality. If you have short telomeres, you're more likely to have cardiovascular disease, or more likely to die. And then genetics. The genes that have been shown to be associated with telomeric lengths are starting to show one-to-one association either with cardiovascular disease and with longevity. So these are members of my groups that has contributed to the studies that I shared with you. And of course, many thanks to multiple collaborators throughout the world in this data set. And I will stop now.
Okay, so thank you all for coming, and thank you, Dr. Aviv, for a very thought-provoking and provocative lecture, and it's my job to ask you some thought-provoking and provocative questions. So I know we work together, and we've talked a lot about these issues prior, so that's my full disclosure for this. But as I was thinking about this over the last few weeks, wondering about the predictions and the implications for chronic disease from telomere biology and from all of the data that you've shown us today. So I have some questions related to that. First question, actually, we spoke about a little bit in the car this morning driving in, and that has to do with intergenerational transmission of chronic disease risk related to telomere length. And I brought up in the car driving in this morning, if the paternal age effect is true, and that older fathers, which are becoming more prevalent in society, have offspring with longer telomeres, does that mean that the age at which chronic diseases, such as cardiovascular disease in particular, will begin later? And will we actually see a shift in the demographics to longer lifespan?
Yeah, so anybody knows what's the frequent of spontaneous mutation in the male germline? Very low. Yeah, there was a paper in Nature a year ago that showed about 2.1 mutation happened per year in the male germline. Now, why is it so important? Because many, even scientists, don't realize that evolution in mammals is driven primarily through the male germline. Anybody knows why? So there was a hint when I asked about that spontaneous mutation. The reason is that women are born with a full set of eggs, and there is not much replication during extrauterine life. In males, you have spermatogenesis continuously, meaning that every time you have replication, you have more likelihood chance of spontaneous mutation just in the process of replication. So in mammals, evolution is driven through the male germline. Now, that paper in Nature argued that they now could explain a lot of diseases of aging, schizophrenia, and autism that have been related to paternal age. I don't buy that. When you see diseases associated with paternal age, they're usually rare. Yeah, autism is maybe 1 in 100 or so now. But if you're looking at other diseases like achondroplasia or Marfan syndrome, all of these are about 1 in 10,000, 1 in 20,000. So the story of disease in paternal age, from the perspective of telomeres, I don't think it's the story of mutation. I think it's the story of the transmission of longer telomeres, really by Mendelian principle of longer telomeres from the father to the offspring. Now, the question is, how much telomeres become longer in one generation of transmission? It's enormous. Just giving you the number. You saw the tremendous scatter. But in fact, for each year of paternal age, the offspring gain, on average, about 15 to 20 base pairs. If you make the mathematics, we've seen only several generations, our telomeres could increase by 100 or 200 base pairs. And this is the difference that we see between individuals with or without atherosclerosis. So we argue that we are witnessing now this new rapid evolution, adding actually new nucleotides to the human genome that is much, much faster than any effect of mutation. So I think the impact of PAC, paternal age reconstruction, will be enormous. And I think what we will see is that we'll have less cardiovascular disease, and maybe I didn't touch upon the subject, more cancer as a trade-off for this.
Jack.
Yeah, I'd like to ask you, thank you for this, and for this very important body of work. I'd like to ask a question about the differentiation of aging and senescence. You talk a lot about aging appropriately, and it's clearly a risk factor for a variety of diseases. But if telomere length is really a biomarker of aging, what that means is that it is an effective predictor of the non-disease associated changes that occur with advancing age, which we call senescence. They're the changes in pulmonary function and immune function and skeletal function and muscular function, et cetera, that underlie the risk of older people. So that we've always felt that in order to be a legitimate biomarker of senescence, that you had to predict these changes, these non-pathological better than your birth certificate. It had to be a better predictor than your birth date. And so I wonder if you thought about differentiating senescence from the risks associated with advancing age, and whether you have any data with respect to the relationship of telomere length to those physiological changes.
Right. So again, please remember that to relate telomeric length in vivo versus telomeric length in vitro in cultured cells to various phenotypes is a totally different story. I first of all would agree with you immediately in saying there is not any biomarker or biodeterminant that is better than your age chronologically. There is no way. In fact, if I would find a biomarker that as good as chronological age, then there's no reason to use that biomarker anyway, because it tells you the same thing. So it's the deviation, this chronological age, of a given biomarker that maybe will give you the story. In other words, if a biomarker tells you that, in fact, your so-called biological age is older than your chronological age, that'll be a great biomarker, or perhaps a biodeterminant. Unfortunately, as was raised in the introduction to my talk, it's extremely difficult to demonstrate this in vivo. But what I'll try to convey to you in my last slide is this, that if you look at the same concept from different perspectives, they all converge to a single story, then you start believing more in the parameters I look at. And I show you basically from the genetic point of view, from the demographic point of view, and the issue of precedence, there is enough evidence to suggest that telomeres are biodeterminant in aging. But you are raising an issue here, or longevity. You're saying, yeah, but there's a difference between aging and longevity and disease of aging. But I don't think so from telomere point of view, there is a difference. And I'll explain to you what I mean. In the final analysis, it has to do with reserves that we have. Aging or disease of aging is a phenomenon of reserve capacity. I believe that the relationship with telomeric lengths and atherosclerosis, for example, is the fact that you have too short telomeres. You have difficulty in repairing injury because you don't have enough replicative potential to do that. We always think about disease as injury, inflammation, oxidative stress. But we somehow forget is another element for injury, and this is the repair. Young individuals are capable of repairing injury much better than older individuals. And there where disease come into picture. So there, it's not any more simple an issue of aging versus disease. You could see how could they fuse together once you're dealing with the reserve capacity to repair. And there where I believe the story of telomeres lies.
Thank you. Well, I kind of have two questions. The first is, we've seen in the same person over time lengthening telomeres. I don't know how common that is. It does occur in some people. And sort of whether that's just due to assay variation or not, I'm not sure.
That's the first question, okay.
And the second question is, could you talk a little bit about telomeres in the brain, in brain cells?
Well, let me answer the second question. There is nothing of telomeres in the brain cells, as far as I know, very little. And I would love to look at it, not in terms of neuronal cells, but the glia. I would love to look at the glia because this is supportive cells. And I believe that we might find out that a lot of our Alzheimer's will end up to have actually also short telomeres in the glial cell. I would love to do this kind of study. And I know that here the neurology department, there are a lot of people that are looking at this and would love to do this. Let me address the first question. The story of telomeric lengthening is basically noise. It's a technical error. We published on that. We were the first to report telomeric lengthening in longitudinal study. And I came with all the biological explanation for it. And then I became very suspicious because everybody has replicated our finding. That's already makes you very suspicious when the replication has started. We only predicted about 5% of individuals will have lengthening. And then all the time we see 40% and 50% and so on. Everybody always lengthens their telomeres. So I started thinking about it. It was obvious to us it is all measurement error of the telomere lengths at baseline and follow-up. And we did the definite studies based on empirical stuff and mathematical computation showing that it's all a measurement error. If your measurement error is high, the duration of the follow-up is short, relatively short, then a lot of the individual will look like they lengthen the telomeres. We publish at least two papers on this. If you look under my name, you'll find those papers. So the telomere lengthening phenomena, which I alluded to, by the way, in my second slide, is totally an artifact. It doesn't exist in somatic tissue. It does exist in the male germ.
Okay, so I can ask another question. So what I'd like to do, and you didn't go through much of the literature on sort of what I'll call social variables, because in a way, I think telomere length, from my reading of some of the literature, is an intersection between social and biological variables. And there's a lot of literature, whether or not we believe it or not, maybe up in question, relating social circumstances to telomere length, social class, adverse experiences in childhood, to reduction in telomere length, and perhaps, although the cohorts haven't been followed long enough, to increase chronic atherosclerosis later on in, or earlier atherosclerotic heart disease later in life. So I wonder if you could comment on whether or not telomeres could be viewed as the intersection between the social and the biological.
The first paper on the link between low socioeconomic status and telomeric lengths was published in Aging Cells on Twins UK. We measured the telomeres for that study. There were a couple of commentaries on this paper, and they were very, very critical. They did not believe anything that the paper stated. I responded by saying, I don't know what's true or not, but these are the measurements, and the problem is that where other groups did not find it may relate to the fact, again, the size of the cohort or the sample that was used, and the other thing is the measurement that we use on PCR-based methods which are very have high measurement error. To make a long story short, now, when people use large population, the socioeconomic status has been shown to be again and again true. And that is individual with low socioeconomic status have shorter telomeres. That's known. That I'll come back in a minute. Okay. So there's no doubt in my mind that low socioeconomic status is associated with shorter telomeres. In fact, there was a study came out on the Kaiser Permanente stuff, the upstart study come out with large-scale studies. We've done 100,000 people. This was done using buccal mucosa telomeres, measured by qPCR. But all that study confirmed that blacks have longer telomeres than whites. Also, we attack on that. And the people with low socioeconomic status, in fact, indeed have shorter telomeres. So that's given. Now, let's think about socioeconomic status. Usually, it's associated with smoking, associated with BMI, high BMI. All of that in and of itself also could explain some of the fact that telomeres are shorter. But maybe there is something above and beyond that because, in fact, life starts in utero. Maybe the tremendous impact of socioeconomic status on the intrauterine milieu. And as I show you, for example, there are differences that we could see already between males and females in terms of telomeric length. But all of these environmental factors put together, you know, we were the first to show the effect of smoking, by the way, exercise, obesity. All of these studies that came from our group in collaboration with everybody else, and eventually this were replicated. Together, jointly, the impact of these elements together is at best 15% of the absolute length of telomeres. In the final analysis, the main determinant of telomeric length is heritability. It's somewhere between 55 to 80%, paternal age at conception, race, and sex. Now, the impact of the environment during adult life is minimal. But I'm coming back to your question. I don't know how much of what we have in utero and the impact of socioeconomic on telomeric lengths, I do not know. And that will be a very seminal study to look at this very issue.
Okay, so going back to paternal age, actually. So could one explanation for the paternal age phenomena be that older fathers are healthier fathers and have better lifestyle habits? They don't smoke. They're normal weight, they're not obese, and they, because they live a healthier lifestyle, they promote healthier lifestyles in their children as well, because I think most of the data you showed on paternal age have to do with studies that ask adults when you measure telomeres in the adults, you ask them how old their parents were when they were born. So it's not actually a prospective study. It's almost a retrospective study. Could many of these lifestyle variables, both in the father and during the life course of the child, up until the time the telomeres were measured, actually influence the conclusion that, I know we'll have the better data because we're doing it at birth, influence the conclusion that paternal age right now is a large determinant of telomere length because it's telomere length in adulthood of the offspring?
I cannot exclude this possibility. Unfortunately, there has not been any, to my knowledge, a longitudinal study looking at the individual donating the sperm at a certain age than 10 years or 15 years later. Also, all the fathers belong to a high socioeconomic status usually. There are so many reasons there, so I do not know the answer. You are raising the important issue, could it be still a selection of the level of the individual, not only the level of the sperm? Because if all the fathers are the high socioeconomic status, whatever that is, so I cannot give you an answer for this. I think the study should be done to see exactly the story. Yeah.
I'll just say a little bit about the study that we're collaborating on, which is a birth cohort study done here using a cohort of pregnant women. And we'll be actually looking at the paternal age effect in a more prospective manner so that we'll be able, we don't have the lifestyle habits of the fathers, unfortunately, but we do of the mothers. And we will be able to look at it, whether or not paternal age actually influenced telomere at birth rather than in adulthood.
Right, so we looked at that. Good, wonderful idea and a good, good suggestion. We looked at that, and we looked at it, have to look at it in large cohorts. Unfortunately, the pack effect, remember, the implant is about 15 to 20 base pair per year. The difference between siblings usually is rarely 20 or 30 or 40 years apart. So when you're dealing with siblings, they're about, the range is about 2 or 3 or 4 years difference, even 10 years. You're reaching the magnitude of telomere measurement that we see in the measurement error. So we could not see that. But you know, if you find individual, if the parents are maybe 20 years apart, there are some of those, very few, then maybe we'll be able to capture that. But otherwise, it's too narrow to see that. In fact, it's a great idea. That's the first thing that we did in our large-scale studies. We looked at the order, birth order, and see if it's in relation to telomeres, and we could not find anything.
Firstly, I want to thank you. It was very interesting. I apologize that I came in the middle, so maybe my question will not be relevant. But I would like to ask you about previous studies that show, I'm studying schizophrenia especially, that shows that father's age sometimes is correlated. There are relations with schizophrenia. How do you explain it? And another thing, there is a contrast. What about the mothers, I'm asking? The women, because we see that in some studies, mothers who give birth in older age, sometimes there is more frequencies of abnormalities in their babies. So how do you explain this?
So first of all, let me focus on the schizophrenia story because, in fact, there were studies done already in the past looking at telomeric lengths in different tissue of schizophrenics, including brain and blood. The most recent study came in blood. They're all done by qPCR, which is a method that has a high measurement error, and they were all over the place. Yes, longer, shorter, and all of that stuff. I was, however, very much intrigued by the schizophrenia and autism because of the paternal age effect. And I developed a model that I thought would work very nicely explaining the relationship between telomeres and schizophrenia. I shared it with Ezra Sasser, who is my collaborator here, who has connection with the NIH, and they saw the model and they liked it so much that they released within about 2 months DNA from 200 schizophrenic and 200 control, very, very tightly matched. Where young schizophrenic, they do not have the effect of medication for many years, were restricted to one sex, males, and no race effect, and no blacks and whites. And the telomeric length in the schizophrenic and control was basically identical. But I don't care what's coming out in the literature. I know that there is no differences. So I could not relate schizophrenia to telomeric length. I must add, however, that I would love to test the model still with autism. And there are, you know, there are elements in the model that makes great sense. We could link genes and many other things. So if anybody here that is interested in autism and he has enough, a large population of autistic kids with that he could get blood and controls, I would love to do this study, and I'll be very happy to share with you this model. But now you raise another issue, and this is the mother's side. I have to tell you something about the mother versus father, even in terms of telomeres themselves. All the mothers are married to all the fathers. The relationship between paternal and maternal age is very, very strong. The R values all start with at least 0.8 or more. So in fact, statistically, despite all the statistics, you cannot dissociate the mother from the father's effect. But it makes sense biologically that it's the father's effect because the father has longer telomeres. In the sperm, there is no evidence that in the eggs, telomeres increase with age. In fact, they become shorter. Now, very, very few studies in eggs, because by definition, you could have very easily sperm from male. It's very hard to get eggs. And then you have one egg, and the measurement in one egg could be only by fish technology that is very inaccurate. So in general, though we don't distinguish statistically, biologically, it makes sense that longer telomeres come from the father and not from the mother. Now, of course, mothers do other things in terms of, but in mother, you're talking about usually chromosomal abnormalities associated with it. It's called structural abnormalities. I would like to propose to you something very interesting here. There's something about older mothers and longevity also. There are studies that suggest that women who give birth to old, at old age, beyond age 40, actually live longer. There are quite a few of us. And I would like to propose to you a very fascinating evolutionary story here. And we'll start with a model of the fruit fly. In the fruit fly, if you select the flies based on delayed egg laying, within a matter of several generations, you'd create the so-called Methuselah drosophila. Those fruit flies could live 5 times longer just by this selection by delayed egg laying. I would like to propose to you that the story of longevity and telomeres is along the same lines. The females transmit longevity maybe through telomeres also via mutation. It's the fact that they have, if they have gene, variant genes that associate with longer or shorter telomeres, they'll have that. The male then adapts very fast. This the epigenetic phenomena of lengthening of telomeres by just effect of selection. So you have transmission, and there is evidence, in fact, that telomeres here are inherited to a larger extent from the mother rather than from the father. The most recent study came in the European Journal of Genetics about based on 30,000 people. We showed that in The Lancet about 7-8 years ago, that telomeres are inherited more with the X chromosome. X chromosome is also the father, but you have 2 X's from the mother. So I believe that there are 2 elements here. One through mutations from the mother, and to a larger extent through this lengthening in the germline for the father. And that's how, with respect to telomeres, longevity plays, you know, it's balanced. But of course, longevity is not the story of telomeres alone, you know. In fact, if you look at longevity, it's about maybe 25% of it at best is heritable.
Thank you.
I'll do one final question, and that's because your talk, it was brilliant, but it's very disheartening because obviously you can't do much about it. So I wanted to ask you about the implications of this work, and can individuals, and you started off with a very interesting slide about the companies that are now advertising on the web to measure telomeres. What if you come back and your telomeres are in the 25th percentile for your age, sex, and race group? What happens then? What can you do about it, or do you just have to accept the fact that you're doomed? So,
well, it's difficult to be fatalistic, but from the telomere perspective, I think that's the story. Unfortunately, every time we write a paper, the co-author suggests to me, you could not end this like this. You have to be optimistic. Say early intervention, whatever it means. But yeah, unfortunately, I think if you have shorter telomeres as a adult, it's over for you. That does not mean.
I'm a short-term investor. Right?
But remember, but there is a trade-off here. Evolution always played this wonderful trade-off. I argue, and I think we are putting now together a large study with the NASA's health study, in which we're looking at what I believe the story of telomeres is the story of antagonistic pleiotrophy theory. Humans have short telomeres because of the fact that they're the longest living organism, because otherwise they would not have that long life. They need to have short telomeres, because if you have long telomeres, and they've been shown by species, you're more likely to have cancer. This is the classical trade-off. So we have short telomeres, so we are more cancer resistant than other mammals, and there is not, all the evidence suggests that this is the case. But the trade-off of these is a limit to our longevity. So we are, in fact, in the NASA's health study, are looking at the cancer, but individuals with longer telomeres, in fact, are more prone to cancer during early life. But if they did not have cancer or survive cancer, they are more likely to be more resistant to cardiovascular disease later in life. So it's not all bad. People ask me, do you know what your telomere length is? Sure, I know. That the experimentation, when I did the measurement at the beginning, well, my blood continuously. I basically walked around like an drug addict because of But I wrote a paper with Calvin Harley, who was, if the mother of the telomere story is Elizabeth Blackburn, who discovered telomeres, the father is Calvin Harley, who built one of this company. I convinced him to write a paper, a philosophical paper with me years ago, and the title of the paper, how long your telomeres should be. And the answer was, of course, we don't know, but if we had the choice for ourselves, we would like to be in the middle. So that's the
Thank
message.
You very much. Thanks.